Arizona Wildlife Views, brought to you by the sale of hunting and fishing licenses and the Heritage Fund, lottery dollars working for wildlife. Some projects made possible by the Sport Fish and Wildlife Restoration Fund.
Welcome to Arizona Wildlife Views. I'm Jim Paxson. On tonight's show, we'll meet some special kids who love fishing. Then we'll unveil a mystery at one of our urban lakes. But first, did you know that Aldo Leopold's first duty station was right here in Arizona?
There are some who can live without wild things, and some who cannot. I'm glad that I will not be young in a future without wilderness.
Considered by many to be the father of wildlife management and of the United States wilderness system, Aldo Leopold was a conservationist, forester, philosopher, educator, writer, an outdoor enthusiast.
Aldo Leopold was born in Burlington, Iowa in 1887. Aldo spent his youth roaming the marshes of the Mississippi River. His dad taught him how to hunt. His mother taught him how to explore and how to pursue creative things like opera. In fact, he couldn't get binoculars, so he used her opera glasses to watch birds when he was a young man.
His mother also assured that he had a background in philosophy.
We shall never achieve harmony with the land any more than we shall achieve absolute justice or liberty for people. In these higher aspirations, the important thing is not to achieve, but to strive.
When Aldo was young, he reveled at exploring swamps and wetlands. He was disturbed by the plowing of prairies, by the damming of rivers, by the draining of wetlands, and the changes those actions brought on the landscape. He attended Yale, where he was trained as a forester to manage lands.
Aldo Leopold arrived in Holbrook, Arizona after graduation from Yale Forestry School. He came to the White Mountains, right where we're standing.
When he arrived in Arizona, he began to see things differently. He began to see a bigger picture. He began to see himself as a member of a larger community that included the land and the animals. He was more about ecosystems. He was more about man as a member of an ecological community, not a conqueror or a dictator, but one who worked in concert with his surroundings.
There was considerable conflict between the ranchers and the fledgling Forest Service over the regulation of grazing. Aldo married into a ranching family that grazed sheep on the Santa Fe, but from that union came harmony and understanding.
Aldo also saw that the very things that were used to decimate wildlands, the axe, the plow, the cow, and fire, can be used to restore wildlands if used appropriately and ethically.
The land ethic simply enlarges the boundaries of the community to include soils, waters, plants, and animals, or, collectively, the land.
Ethics direct individuals to cooperate with each other for the mutual benefit of all. One of his philosophical achievements was the idea that this community should be enlarged to include non-human elements, such as soils, waters, plants, and animals, or collectively, the land.
That land is a community is the basic concept of ecology. But that land is to be loved and respected is an extension of ethics. A land ethic, then, reflects the existence of an ecological conscience, and this, in turn, reflects a conviction of individual responsibility for the health of the land.
Leopold's greatest contribution was a land ethic, an essay that's in Sand County Almanac. In it, his premise is that man is a member of the community. The ecological community is, it's the land, it's the animals, it's the plants, and man's a member. And we have to treat that community with respect and be a partner in the management of it.
The land ethic is a result of understanding the interrelationships of the natural system. It's not something that Dad all of a sudden realized. It took him a lifetime to understand how interrelated we are with the natural system.
And never did we have perspective on this until we all finally grew up.
In 1935, Aldo and his family initiated their own ecological restoration experiment on a worn-out farm along the Wisconsin River outside of Baraboo County, Wisconsin.
It was totally decimated. All it had on it was an old shack. Everything was in bad shape. There he began to evolve in his philosophies on caring for the land, and he was active with his family in restoring that area to be productive.
Planting thousands of trees, restoring prairies, and documenting the ensuing changes in the flora and fauna further informed and inspired Leopold. To conservationists, that shack has come to symbolize man's effort to build a healthier relationship between people and nature. Today, people come from all over the world to see what Aldo started so many decades ago.
It's astonishing to me and exciting to see how the shack has attracted people. My father would be absolutely amazed.
Aldo was a hunter from his youth to his very last year on this life. He found reason in hunting.
Aldo and the district ranger Wheatley shot some wolves, and they got there in time to watch the green fire and the old she-wolf die. Aldo was a hunter. He thought less wolves meant more deer. Neither he nor the mountain agreed in later years.
We reached the old wolf in time to watch a fierce green fire dying in her eyes. And I realized then, and have known ever since, that there was something new to me in those eyes, something known only to her and to the mountain. Well, I was young then and full of trigger itch, and I thought that because fewer wolves meant more deer, that no wolves would mean a hunter's paradise. But after seeing the green fire die, well, I sensed that neither the wolf nor the mountain agreed with such a view.
We need the wolf, but it must be managed. We need to be able to have the right number of wolves with the right number of elk with the right number of deer. It's a study in contrasts.
Only the mountain has lived long enough to listen objectively to the howl of the wolf.
We gained many perspectives from Aldo Leopold, and a base from which to grow. But science can't stop. It's an ever-evolving basis of how to manage these lands so that they're here for our children and our grandchildren, and even their children. It's a science that's going to grow, and we must continue to strive forward. I think that we've come through an era of conflict. The 80s and 90s and even into this century, we need to get away from that. We need to come to the table. We need to attack issues instead of each other. We need to be busy about seeking solutions. The land depends on us to help out with the management, as do the animals that reside on the land. Remember, we're one part of the community, and we always want to seek solutions for the betterment of the land and the communities that live on it.
Like winds and sunsets, wild things were taken for granted until progress began to do away with them. Now we face the question whether a still higher standard of living is worth its cost in things natural, wild, and free.
I've been doing this event probably since Zach was about in first grade, and he's now a ninth grader at Stapley Junior High. So this is something that he really looks forward to every year. We absolutely love Arizona Game and Fish. They put on a great event for these kids.
The event Cindy's talking about is the annual Challenged Kids Fishing Clinic. This extremely popular event is hosted by the Arizona Game Rangers Association and personnel from the Mesa Regional Office.
We just can't help but be out here to help these wonderful kids learn how to fish, because they're Their energy is boundless and is completely 100% contagious. The Game and Fish officers are here. They want to help. This is one of the funnest things that they get to do all year long. When the call comes out to help with the annual Challenge Kids Fishing Clinic, you have to beat guys off with a stick. We have too much help. So they really, really enjoy coming out here. The smiles that are generated, the lifetimes of memories that are created are something that we all enjoy. And teaching the kid to fish and then sharing the outdoor experiences is what the Arizona Game Ranger FOP Lodge and the Game and Fish Department's all about. And we're 100% behind that, and it's one of the funnest things we do all year.
It has been said that you can't hit a home run unless you step up to the plate. You can't catch a fish unless you put your line in the water. And you can't reach your goals if you don't try. Those life lessons are the key benefits that today's anglers experience.
What I see the benefit to the Challenge Kids community and the Mesa High School programs is having the students realize that there's nothing that they can't do. There is no limits to them. They put their mind to a task, and the only limitations that they have in their life is those that they impose on themselves. And we're here to show them that indeed they can do anything they want. You know, and working with the game rangers to teach them how to fish is a wonderful way to expose them to the outdoors and to show them that there's even outdoors activities are not outside the realm of possibility for these guys. The outdoor experience is something for everybody in Arizona. And the Challenge community, we want to welcome them with open arms and show them that there is an opportunity and a place for them in the outdoors.
Fishing provides a connection with the entire living world. It gives the angler the opportunity to be totally immersed in the now, while reflecting about the then and anticipating the next. While fishing may be a form of meditation, there is nothing like the rush one gets from that tug on the line.
Ben gets so excited when he feels the tug on the line. His eyes light up, and you can see the joy in his heart and in his face, and to see it get closer and closer. And he loves to be the first one to catch the most. He just really enjoys the thrill of feeling the tug on the line.
Give it a kiss. There you go.
All right.
Toss it in the lake. Woo! There he goes.
Ben's not the only avid angler in this group.
Yep, he likes to get here bright and early, and he did catch the first fish. That's something he really enjoys. He's got a few trophies at home from past years.
While the event is about fishing and the special anglers, one can't help but notice the thrill in the eyes of the aides and the instructors alike.
Well, the biggest thrill is to see one of these kids catch a fish and their reaction. Some of them will stay here all day and try to catch a fish. You talk about patience and persistence, and we try to recognize that. We give out some little prizes to folks for that. We've had some of these kids sit out in the rain and the cold all day long until they've caught a fish. And when they catch it, it's just amazing how thrilled they are. It's kind of like when you remember when you caught your first fish. So actually, yes, it's more enjoyable, it's more thrilling to see one of them catch a fish than it is for, at least for me, to catch one. Or it's just like, you know, giving is more joyful than receiving. So when you see these kids receiving, it's a real joy.
Good job. All right, now let's hold it right there. Hold on tight. Hold on tight. Keep it in your lap. Keep it in your lap right there.
While turning the crank might be problematic, and even the simple task of holding the rod may seem daunting, every kid deserves the chance to go fishing.
I've been working at Hermosa Vista 6 years. This is my sixth year. I love it. We work with the same group of kids from kindergarten through sixth grade. And we have an awesome time together. They're great. They're just, I don't know, they're just so sweet and innocent. Not that all kids aren't sweet and innocent, but they just have some really great personalities. They're fun to work with. I love working with this group.
There is nothing more wholesome than a family enjoying a fishing outing together. The kids will remember it forever, but so will the parents. When they become bonded to the outdoors, they become stewards of the outdoors. When we all become stewards of the outdoors, that's when we know our wildlife future is assured. That's a critical part of our agency's mission, is connecting people with their outdoor heritage.
Henry David Thoreau once said that many men go fishing all of their lives without knowing that it's not the fish they're after. It might simply be enjoying the peace and serenity of a calm lake or gently flowing stream, or in sharing the water with a friend. In Zach's case, it's a chance to renew friendships with his favorite game rangers.
Yeah, he loves to fish, and really he loves meeting and connecting with the Arizona Game and Fish Rangers. He's had one that we've connected with for many years, Stu. He just loves Stu, and he gets to come out here and talk to him and compare stories and chit-chat. They have a really good time. They have great mentors. These guys go out of their way to be extra patient and work with these kids. We really appreciate it.
This is a real special day for our employees, too. This is a way that they can give back to the community by being a part of taking care of our community of people with special needs. We're also a part of our community at large.
Good job.
I think it helps me, and it probably helps other people as well, to remember that what we see on the outside is not who or what we really are. It's what's on the inside that is the measure of each person. And we get bound up by what we look at and kind of identify people with what we see. And it helps us to remember we have to look inside to see what a person really is. And each year reminded how beautiful and how strong and how wonderful these folks are that come out here to participate in it. Not only the children that have some sort of disability or challenge or whatever, but the people that work with them, their teachers, their parents, and then also the folks that come out just to help. I know the kids enjoy it. They love it every year. They can't wait to do it every year. But I'll tell you that the folks that help them, it's the same for them. I think our hearts are strengthened and encouraged even more than the kids are through this event. So it's just a wonderful experience.
Well, this is something that's very near and dear to my heart. When Tim called me and said, can we put this together, I kind of took it on as my own little mission. And it's not just my clinic, obviously, but it's a partnership and gathering up all the interested folks in the Game Rangers Lodge who had a passion for doing this was the strength of this particular clinic, and every one of them who comes out here takes away a little piece of these kids with them in their heart when they go home, and it's just one of the most rewarding, empowering, and personally important things that we get to do, and something I'm very proud of, and something I wouldn't miss.
I want to give a shout out to Arizona Game and Fish, not just for today, but for stocking the urban lakes and for what they do up on the rim. Because we fished all around, and without their programs, we wouldn't have this father-son time and enjoy the tug on the pole. So we really appreciate the Arizona Game and Fish for putting this on for us.
Shout out right back at you, Dan. Connecting people with their outdoor heritage is the very core of the Arizona Game and Fish Department. It's what we do, it's who we are, and always will be. Take a kid fishing. It's an experience you'll both remember forever.
Pretty cool, man.
I want to toss it back.
You want to toss it back?
Yeah, this sounds like a good idea.
There are some brazen thieves in our valley who've been stalking our local waterways and making off with their haul in broad daylight.
We've been having some issues on our urban lakes with thieves. They're a non-game migratory bird called a cormorant. They're extremely effective in diving underwater and finding many of our trout that we stock in our urban program lakes.
The double-crested cormorant is widespread across North America and is the only cormorant that occurs in large numbers inland near freshwater as well as on the coast. Their diet consists primarily of fish which they catch by diving underwater, propelled by their powerful webbed feet. They're often seen floating low in the water, neck and bill raised, or perching upright to dry their outstretched wings. Lately, Chaparral Lake in Scottsdale has become one of their favorite haunts.
Of our 21 lakes in the urban program, Chaparral Lake is our worst case scenario. There's a island on this lake that serves as a bit of a sanctuary, a refuge, if you will, for the cormorants to perch and to roost in. We have found in excess of 200 birds at any one time on this particular island alone. They tend to stay here overnight. The numbers are great in the morning, and then throughout the day they'll move in and out of this island and up and down the surrounding areas in search of sources of fish.
And when one of those sources of fish is a stocking truck loaded with trout, the birds don't have to search very far.
The cormorants can feed on anywhere from 1 to 2 trout a day. And when we're talking about anywhere of 100 to 200 birds at a time at this park, you can see that when we stock 300 or 400 rainbow trout, these thieves, I call them shoplifters, can take most of my inventory out of the water and create poor fishing conditions and frustrations for our anglers.
So who's doing better?
The birds. The birds are doing better.
We've actually been monitoring this lake now this last year, and then 5 years ago, and interviewed fishermen to get a better feel for how fishing success is and how satisfied and how many people use this park. And we've noticed that in this last year, there's fewer people fishing this lake and fewer people that are catching trout out of this lake. And much of that is a result of these cormorants.
The damage done to the urban fishing population is only part of the problem. The birds are also leaving their mark on the community.
One other aspect to the cormorants that's also a problem on the landscape and even from a human health and safety standpoint is that when we get extreme concentrations of these birds, particularly as we've seen here at Chaparral as they roost and perch on the trees of this island, is that they use these trees and palm trees as their restrooms as well. And so they're urinating and defecating and creating a whitewash effect high in urine. There's times we can begin to smell the concentrated urine out here on this island, and it also essentially defoliates the trees.
The cormorants aren't the only birds fouling the area. A wide variety of species are attracted to the lake due to the many food sources available there.
One of the challenges we do face in these aquatic environments in the cities is the challenge of birds. It's great for watchable wildlife to see some birds coming around the lake and enjoy that. But unfortunately, in many cases in these urban settings, we have issues with excesses. Excessive numbers of pigeons, excessive numbers of domestic ducks, excessive numbers of Canada geese, as well as the cormorants.
The city of Scottsdale is considering some changes to the island at Chaparral Lake, which will make the environment a little less attractive to the cormorants. In the meantime, the urban fishing program will continue to serve thousands of anglers.
The urban fishing program has been in place for over 25 years now. It's a tremendous program. It's all about if people can't get to the fish, we bring fish to the people. We stock these lakes every other week for 10 months out of the year. Winter months get rainbow trout. In the fall and in the spring, we stock really nice sized channel catfish. And it's a program that helps people just to enjoy a quality of life. It makes fishing convenient to them. These fish are great to eat. It's a great environment for folks of all ages, abilities, families, the elderly, seniors, first-timers and experienced anglers. The urban program is great for all folks.
Richard Cortez of Chandler brought his son to the lake for his first fishing experience after looking up the location online.
This is more nearby. You know, this only took 25 minutes compared to like an hour and a half to the closest one we'd have to go to. And since this is our first time fishing, we just thought, easier to just come here and throw it in the lake than a stream going down. Little hiccups here and there, little tangles. It's his first time, so just kind of playing it by ear.
Young people represent 25% of the urban program participants. In addition to catching healthy and delicious trout and catfish, anglers benefit socially and psychologically by spending time with friends and family. And despite the current challenges with the cormorants at Chaparral Lake, urban fishing continues to be a fun family activity.
My choice of worms is a 6 or 7 inch Robo fat. This one is in the color of Prism Crawler. It's a natural bait. When I choose baits, I really kind of try and keep it simple. When I go into a tackle shop, man, there's all kinds of colors, there's all kinds of things. I basically simplify it for myself, okay? The fish only have three or four sources of food that they're gonna eat. Crayfish, okay? Bluegills, and threadfin shad. I'm not saying that they won't eat other baby bass and baby, but baby bass, baby bluegills, baby carp, baby catfish, I'd call those brim. So I like to go just with a natural color, okay? Basically, two or three different colors of worms for me work, which is a shad pattern. This prism crawler here is actually imitating like a night crawler, okay? It's a natural type bait. So when I'm using robo-worms, I keep two or three colors, a shad pattern, a bluegill pattern, and a natural pattern. And then maybe a fourth would be like a crayfish pattern, a soft shell craw. But we're gonna use a prism crawler today. You're gonna rig a Texas rig. It's very easy. You put the beginning of the hook into the worm to the head of the worm about a quarter inch, and you pull it out. You push the worm up to the top of the eye, rotate that hook 180 degrees, and then set that hook into the belly of the worm so that it's weedless.
Well, that's our show for tonight. For more information on the Arizona Game and Fish Department or anything you've seen in tonight's show, go to our website. For producers Gary Schaefer and Carol Lynn, I'm Jim Paxson. We'll see you next week.